Rosamund Franklin, according to me, is a biologist. I think he has made a work on the structure of deoxyribonucleic acid. He studied it and made a foundation on the discovery of the structure of the double helix of deoxyribonucleic acid.
Rosamund Franklin, he's the second president, I believe, of America.
She's a scientist who is a physicist, and she discovered and gave few formulae, discovered few stuff.
Rosalind Franklin is a chemist cum biologist. Her contributions revolve around the DNA structure. I'm sure like everybody knows Watson and Crick model. So yes, her contributions are on the DNA structure and molecules, yeah.
Have you ever seen this picture? It's only one of the most iconic images in the world of science, so listen close. This is the photo that led to the discovery of the structure of DNA. Now, you probably know that DNA is the hereditary material that is contained in all living organisms. It doesn't matter if we're talking about humans or animals or insects or fishes or this plant, or even bacteria and viruses. If it's living, then it has DNA. And this DNA is basically like a set of instructions that tells any body how to behave, how to perform its functions so that we can stay alive and kicking. And DNA also contains this very important material that you've probably heard about, genes. Genes are what is inherited from generation to generation. So I think you're getting the picture that the DNA is a pretty big deal. It's because we now know the structure of DNA that the world looks the way it is right now. Take forensic science or agriculture or healthcare. We wouldn't be able to do half the things we could now if we didn't know what DNA was about. Let's look at the pandemic. You know that scientists have been able to come up with vaccines, right? They would not have been able to do it unless they understood the genetic material inside viruses. Because of that, we know how the coronavirus infects our body and how we can possibly fight it using vaccine. And if you take the last pandemic, for example, the Spanish flu, which happened in the early 1900s, it killed over 50 million people in 2 years. And the death toll was so high because we simply weren't prepared to deal with such a virus. And back at that time, we did not know what the virus was actually doing and what the scale of the problem we were dealing with. Luckily, we're a little better prepared now. So today, whether or not we are scientists, most of us probably think of something like this when I say DNA. But we didn't always know that DNA looked like this. We know it thanks to the contributions of a few scientists. Let's begin by seeing what your NCERT textbook says about the discovery of the structure of DNA. I'm going to read out. It was only in 1953 that James Watson, Francis Crick, based on the X-ray diffraction data produced by Morris Wilkins and Rosalind Franklin, proposed a very simple but famous double helix model for the structure of DNA. So you see here that it's James Watson and Francis Crick who have been credited with the discovery of the structure of DNA. But you also heard that they based their structure on the data that was obtained by two other scientists, Morris Wilkins and Rosalind Franklin. Which brings us back to this famous photograph. So this photograph was taken by a chemist named Rosalind Franklin, who worked at King's College in London, and it was taken on 6th May 1952. This was Rosalind's 51st attempt at taking a photograph of DNA. And this 51st attempt turned out to be the best and most accurate image that anyone in history had ever taken of DNA. In her notebook, Rosalind labeled this photo as 51, and that's why we today know it as photograph 51. So what exactly do we mean by a photo of DNA? You probably know that DNA is way too small, deep inside our cells, for us to just take a snap of it using a camera or even most microscopes. So what does a photo of DNA mean? Now you have to realize that this is not just any regular photograph of DNA. And Rosalind Franklin was not just any regular photographer. Rosalind was hired to King's College in London for a very specific reason. She was an expert in a specific technique called X-ray crystallography. Let's call that XRC for short. Now, X-rays are a type of electromagnetic waves, just like any light that you see around us. The only difference between X-ray and visible light that we can see is that the wavelength of X-rays are much, much shorter. In fact, they are so short that if you take a beam of X-ray and send it through any substance, any material or an object, the waves are small enough to actually disturb the very electrons in the atoms of these substances. So that makes X-rays really useful to understand the three-dimensional structure of these substances that it passes through. So the time that we are talking about, the late 1940s and the early 1950s, DNA became a really, really big deal. It was just a few years before that it was found out that genes were actually present in DNA. Until then, scientists knew that there were these things called genes that were inherited from parent to offspring, but they didn't really understand what these genes were, where they were present. So when it was found out that genes are actually present in these molecules called DNA, that made DNA the star of the show. And there was this big frenzy all across the world. All scientists wanted to become the first to uncover the three-dimensional structure of DNA. What you see in photograph 51 is the pattern that is created when an X-ray beam is zoomed through a small, really pure sample of DNA fiber. Just from this image, which looks pretty vague to us, right? But it's really informative. Using just this image, Rosalind Franklin was able to deduce a lot of things. For example, that DNA was made up of two long strands and that these two strands were arranged in a helical fashion, like you can see here. She was also able to say a lot of other things, but we won't get into that right now. But basically, thanks to this picture, she made some pretty big discoveries. But the thing was, Rosalind Franklin wasn't really interested in joining this race. She didn't believe that her science could be reduced to a mere race and a fight for glory. There were, however, a couple of scientists at least who were very much part of this race and were determined to reach the finish line first. Two of them were James Watson and Francis Crick. Now, James Watson and Francis Crick had already made a little bit of a headway into this problem of discovering the structure of DNA. But the big breakthrough for them really came when Watson visited King's College in London. Remember, King's College was where Rosalind Franklin was working at the time. Watson met Morris Wilkins, who was a colleague of Rosalind, and Morris Wilkins showed Watson something. Photograph 51. But the thing was, Wilkins showed Watson the image without the permission of Rosalind Franklin. When Watson saw the image, he immediately knew that this was going to be something big. He flew back to his own laboratory and joined forces with his partner, Francis Crick, and using what they could find out from Rosalind Franklin's image, as well as a report that she had published about her findings, they were able to crack the structure of DNA. Immediately, they wrote up their paper and published it in a scientific journal, thereby becoming the first scientists to discover the 3D structure of DNA. The interesting thing is that Rosalind Franklin also published her findings in the same journal. It just so happened that her article was published later than theirs. So everybody just assumed that Rosalind Franklin's article was a mere confirmation of the findings that were made by Watson and Crick. So for a long time, nobody knew that behind the famous Watson and Crick's double helix model was the data of Rosalind Franklin. And there was no way this discovery could have been made without her. Watson and Crick never bothered telling Rosalind Franklin that she was a big role in their discovery. And when she died at the age of 39 of ovarian cancer, she died without even knowing the impact of her discovery. The truth only came out when James Watson published his autobiography, in which he said something that shocked the scientific world. He actually said many nasty things about Rosalind Franklin, but in between all of that was this sentence. Rosie, of course, did not directly give us her data. For that matter, no one at King's realized they were in our hands. By then, James Watson had already received a Nobel Prize that he shared with Francis Crick and Maurice Wilkins. Nobody can say whether Rosalind Franklin would have got the prize if she was alive at the time. If you found the story interesting, we're going to include a lot of extra links where you can do some further reading in the description of this video. And make sure that you subscribe to our channel, and we're going to have a few more episodes of this series to come. So tell us what you think.